So my name's Aviva McClure, and I have been an educator for about 20 years in Portland, both as a classroom teacher, an art teacher, and also as a school administrator.
I'm currently a social studies and English language development teacher at Grant High School. My career has been mostly in the area of social studies, history, global studies, all of that. But about 10 years ago, I got an ELD endorsement. So I began working with that population of immigrant kids.
Well, my name is Scott Blevins. I am a high school English teacher at Grant High School in Portland, Oregon. This is my sixth year as a teacher. For the majority of my teaching career, I taught ninth grade English and then another class called Writer's Workshop. This year, I decided to leave the freshman community system and teach junior English.
Black young men, Latinx and indigenous young men in particular, have higher rates of being excluded from school, so suspensions and expulsions, which then increase the rate of their involvement with the criminal justice system.
An aspect of institutionalized racism that impacts young people in schools from as young as like preschool. A lack of culturally relevant curriculum in schools, unequal funding of schools. So there are a lot of different parameters. Lack of resources and programs, low expectations.
You see at third grade is when the first state testing happens in reading comprehension. The prison industrial complex will look at that data to determine how many prisons they should build and like what kinds of, how many beds they should have in their prison.
In Portland public schools, only 3% of teachers identify as Black. And when we see very low numbers of student success rate for Black students, we have to wonder about that correlation.
So it's a multi-pronged kind of animal that is just creating obstacles for particularly historically underserved communities.
Eye contact, sitting still and not talking. However, listening in the home of a student might look very different. It might look like hearing something and telling the person next to you about what you're hearing and your thoughts around it, and then cueing back in, right? When I see teachers shushing students or limiting for long periods of time the talk time, unintentionally, is in the student's mind correlating talking to being naughty, right? Sometimes even to the point of getting kicked out of class or having to go to the principal's office or having a phone call home. It's teachers unintentionally bringing their home culture into the classroom in a way that can be harmful.
You need to focus on the system that creates those obstacles for the individuals. The main one that I could think of is, if you could call it that, is tracking. Schools that have multi-tracks of like AP track, and then you have your regular ed track. And I think those are enclosures. You're saying only a certain population can maneuver and be successful in this area. And those who aren't need to go this other route. Not making a course accessible to a student that may have had some bumps in the road in their education along the way. You know, a student who may want to take an AP class and they notice that their options are AP Geo and AP Human, AP European History, but you don't have an AP World History that takes a look at the whole world.
Just by the way that the education system has always functioned as like you sit, you learn the things that your teacher tells you, and you take that information and put it on a test. Lack of representation in curriculum. A lot of teachers teach about, you know, Eurocentric authors, history, so on and so forth. Another enclosure is a lot of the ways that white students treat black students is another way that black students are forced into certain boxes. A few students opening up curriculum so that there were more black voices in the curriculum, they would get shut down by classmates, you know, just saying like, you're making things too political. I was told from students, it's like, my very existence as a black woman is political.
I think exclusionary discipline is a big one. Exclusion can mean asking a student to go to the hallway, right? Because they're missing instruction. Exclusion can be pulling a student out of a group setting. When we are physically removing the bodies of our brown and black students from a space, it's not only impacting them significantly, it's impacting all of the other students. The way I ask teachers to flip that is, if you're feeling like doing this, do this instead.
And so I think it starts with the teacher. Instead of going automatically into standards and expectations, you have to first look at who's in front of you. Examine your practice as opposed to creating these expectations and standards and giving them no way to actually meet them and be successful.
There's a laundry list of garbage that teachers do. Lecturing is the biggest one, as like the teacher as the arbiter of information, that the only information that can be used in the classroom. It's predominantly older white men that take on that role as lecturer of and conveyor of information, holder of information. Like, there's this old joke in the teaching world, like, don't smile until November, right? And it's about having this us versus them relationship.
So being at the mall in a group, if you look at the experiences of black students and white students, they can be very different. The watchful eye of staff is going to be more in their, you know, in their space than it would be with a group of white students. Community, there's a lot of coaching that we do in black and brown communities with our youth about putting your hood down, pulling up your pants, like, you know, asking students to basically conform so that there's less likelihood that they're going to be targeted. Was there any time black and brown youth are stepping out into the street, there's going to be some level of profiling that happens based on how they're showing up in their skin.
Like going to grocery stores, or like going to, you know, mini marts or 7-Eleven or the Plaid Pantry or whatever, the people working there will follow them around the store. And so like they feel like they have to be on their best behavior. And a lot of students have told me that they felt really embittered because they're like, dude, I'm like 12. The other one is the potential for violence at the hands of police. Almost every black student that I've had has been harassed by the police at one time or another.
I think recognizing the history of police is important. How police were basically deputized overseers from a lot of the plantations. When you think of that history and trajectory and how then police are interacting with schools. So the school policy and policing kind of dovetailed. If you look at our teachers, a lot of times they are middle-aged white women. So a lot of times with like a drug-related something or when there's a charged conversation, it can go from like 0 to 60, like really fast, and before you know it, the police are at the school. Police can be used by people at school in a way that is threatening, and again, like kind of oppressive in terms of like that, this is what we expect, you need to obey kind of thing?
Well, for one, they over-police Black and brown communities. And with that, they over-police the schools in those Black and brown communities. It's not that there is more crime necessarily that's committed in Black and brown communities, but those same crimes, if not worse, happen in suburbs but get unnoticed.
So yes, first of all, I do believe marginalized students need exactly that. I do believe all students need that, because I think a lot of times we actually miss trauma that lives in white wealthy communities by not providing that wraparound support. I think the reason teachers don't do that more often is twofold. Number one, when folks become teachers, they go to school for 4 to 6 years to be a teacher. Mm-hmm. But they've already been to school for 13 years, experiencing teachers, many teachers, right? And so if you think of that, like learning by witnessing, if they haven't had experiences with educators doing it differently or supporting them differently, the mental model of how to be a teacher is already pretty ingrained by the time you go to college, where then you're expected to unlearn the thing that you already did through school and do it differently. So I think it just takes more practice. I think another piece of it is white teachers and the students that they serve. I think that there can be fear with cracking open difficult topics for feeling ill-equipped to handle it. I think there needs to be a lot of skill building, because I see teachers that really want to support and want to learn a different way, but they haven't necessarily been asked to prioritize that in their learning.
Yeah, I think it's extremely important. They need that confidence. And the only way to boost that confidence is to develop relationships with them, especially if they're in a predominantly white environment. They don't want to feel invisible. So oftentimes the way that you give them voice is by reaching out to them and finding out what's going on. And then teachers who don't do that, I think it's because some teachers feel like their job is to deliver the most content and to have students get the most out of what they present. I think teachers don't take time to look at the ones who need a different approach.
One of the biggest successes that I find as a teacher is when I build relationships with students in a way that isn't just based on the work that they provide for me. Being a teacher is my job. It's not who I am. I have to look at my students in the same way. And if I don't put in the work to get to know you first and foremost, then like, why would you work hard for me? And I find that the teachers that phone it in and like just do the thing that they've been doing for like 20 some odd years, those are the people that kids don't remember.
When they sit down in my space, the first thing I say is, oh, you look stressed, or you look worried, you look upset. What's going on? I feel can be the most transformative question. And it's actually the first question in a restorative justice process, is to ask, what happened? Authoritative structure in schools where the teacher is talking to the school principal and then telling the student what happened, as opposed to the student being the center of their own story. Out of the what happened comes the repair.
Banning them from school, I mean, that's just saying we don't want you here. We don't like you, we don't want you. And that sends a very clear signal to a young person who is already feeling crappy about themselves.
It's like, get to know your kids on an individual basis. Is first talk to them and give them the space to work through what's happening. Excluding kids from school through like outside of school suspension is really shitty. and it doesn't, and it ultimately doesn't achieve the goal that you have in mind.
It's making me think back to my very first teaching experience. Very low attendance rate because a lot of students were affiliated with gangs and not showing up to school. Started simply by like creating a playlist, a classroom playlist. And students started to talk about that. Yo, Miss Mac plays our music in class, right? So then more students started coming to class. I had to teach a calligraphy class. And the teacher who had done it before me, you know, had all the quill pens to pull out, and you have to do it a very specific way. And I just kicked it back to students. I'm like, so we could do it this way, or let me show you how calligraphy looks in different cultures. Students landed on graffiti as their mode that they wanted to do. I'm gonna find a wall in our city that we can dedicate to this project that we're gonna do together. So I found a wall, we did a mural project. So to me, it starts with asking youth what they want to learn. I didn't know how to do graffiti stuff before that. I think it's like a reciprocal relationship when teaching and learning becomes that process that students and teachers share.
You know, young people have so much energy, and I think what we need to do is try to figure out what their strengths are and channel that energy into those areas where they can get involved in activities and discover activities that actually allow them to grow as people.
Well, the biggest thing I think is being warm and personable and real. I had a student, was in and out of foster care, was finally in a stable home, but had terrible PTSD and wouldn't, and really, really, really struggled with school. But it took tons of time and sitting down one-on-one in an empty classroom with just me and that student and being like, okay, so you're gonna tell me a story and we're gonna write it together. Now let's break it down paragraph by paragraph. That work was really long and really hard, but the rest of that year, that kid trusted me. And he kept coming back to me.
I love this word, mutual accountability, because I do believe that students are responsible. All students are responsible. Recognize that there's less of a canon and less of a majority voice coming from that group. However, I think it's really important to provide skills. So I really like to have racial caucus space when learning about how to be accountable in those like interracial spaces, because then white students can kind of ask more specific technical questions. How do I do that respectfully? Or how do I interrupt something that's happening at home and not be a bystander?
Well, I think first and foremost, it's the responsibility of the teacher, because the teacher is the one that's sort of creating a classroom culture, setting the standard from the beginning to validate all voices, but particularly the voices of those who are few in number in the classroom. And then not just elevating their voices, but allowing them to be seen in the curriculum. They want to see what Black people, brown people have done to shape this country, and not just how they've been victims of this country.
It really, really lays at the feet of adults to create a culture where students empower one another. As a byproduct of like building a community, students will value each other way more. Where student responsibility comes in, like the Platinum Rule, treat other people how they want to be treated.
I was working with a teacher at a school that is about 90% white. With the eighth grade class, most of the students in that class were white. There were two students that identified as Black male. Both of them in this class got in trouble for moving around the classroom, talking, throwing stuff, throwing art materials, that sort of thing. And the teacher said, I want you to go sit in the office. You're going to be my slave at recess and clean up the classroom. Yeah. In front of the class was not only mortifying for these students, it was like everyone, like you could have heard a pin drop, right? So then these students come to my office, and at that point, it's not even about like the throwing the paper or anything. These students are like, this teacher called us slaves. So one of the two students said, I actually want a restorative process with this teacher. You know, the other student said, I'm not ready for that just yet. So I brought a restorative process a couple days later. I coached the student, I coached the teacher, helped to bring the teacher up to speed on what was said that was so offensive. And then we came together to restore and repair. And as we were talking, the teacher said, well, you speak Spanish, so I didn't know you identified as Black. The teacher wasn't thinking of the student being both Black and Latinx at the same time. That to me is such an alarming, like, there was exclusion, there was name calling that the teacher wasn't even really aware of. There was deepening the harm through the restorative process.
if you as a teacher, if you at some point in your career don't like working with kids and you don't like kids, stop being a teacher, because there's so much stuff that they don't have control of, and you are the person with the locus of control in the classroom, and you have the power to make things a positive experience for kids.
Be chances, the devil dances and eventually answers to the call of autumn. All them falling for the love of balling. Get caught with 30 rocks, the cop looked like Alec Baldwin. Inner century anthems based off inner city tantrums, based off the way we was branded. Face it, Jerome get more time than Brandon. And at the airport, they check all through my bag and tell me that it's random.